This is one of our initiatives to go deeper into specific industries, something that we'll be doing each year. And this year, we want to focus on sports. The person that that's going to be giving the introductions is someone who is a champion when it comes to diversity and inclusion, when it comes to students that are looking to get into corporate America, those who have professional degrees, and those that are moving up within the corporate ladder. They are one of our coalition member organizations. Many of you remember them as the National Society of Hispanic MBAs, also known as NASHIMBA. They are now known as Prospanica. And I'd like to welcome the president and CEO of Prospanica, Tom Savino.
Thank you, Sid. Hey, I was just backstage in, I guess, the green room, and it's a really great panel, so I think you're really going to enjoy it. But first, let's spend a few moments thanking our sponsor for this session, ESPN. Earlier today, I finally got to meet the Vice President of Diversity, Inclusion, and Wellness of ESPN, Monica Diaz. Someone I've actually admired for a very long time and finally got to meet her today. So I'm very thankful, and I want to invite Monica up to say a few words about ESPN.
Good afternoon. Okay. Are we ready to talk about sports? Excellent. So we want to kind of end up this fantastic symposium by having kind of a high-energy conversation about diversity in the business of sports. So I want to just going to thank all my colleagues who are going to become panelists, and Max Bretos, who's going to be the moderator for this panel. But it wouldn't be ESPN if we don't start a conversation about sports with some trends and trivia, right? Okay, are you ready? So did you know which are the countries with most Hispanic Latino players in the NBA? Who ventured to know? Brazil. Brazil has had 10 players in the NBA, followed by which country? Spain, very good, with 9. And then we have a tie of 2 countries. Which are those? Uh-huh, Argentina, and who else? Puerto Rico. So that's a tie with 8 players each. Sid, did you know the first time ever a Dominican played in the US Open was actually in 2014? Victor Estrella Burgos accomplished the feat at 34 years old, making him the oldest ever debutant into the tournament. And did you know, Boricuas on the house, where are they? Okay. Did you know that Roberto Clemente was the first Puerto Rican baseball player to be enshrined to the MLB Hall of Fame? Okay. He was elected posthumously in 1973. And currently, and Wendy can correct me if this is not totally accurate, but I think it is, there's almost 30% of Hispanic players in the MLB. Okay? So with that, did you know that ESPN has been serving Hispanic sports fans for over a decade? ESPN Deportes was launched in 2004. And with shows like A Los Golpes, Cronómetro, Redes, Nación ESPN, and most recently with our bilingual digital platform like One Nación, ESPN serves Hispanic sports fans anytime, anywhere. Every week, ESPN reaches 20 million Hispanic sports fans across all platforms. In 2015 alone, ESPN delivered almost one quarter, 23%, more sports content to Hispanic fans than our closest competitor. So truly we're proud, we're honored to serve our Hispanic sports fans, because serving this audience really requires a team who understands the audience, who can connect to the sports and the cultures of each of the countries we conglomerate under the term Latinos. A team of talented colleagues in front of the camera and behind the camera. A team of colleagues like Max Bretos, Antonieta Collins, Pedro Gomez, Jessica Mendoza, Freddy Lomeli, and many others, Sarina Morales, Marley Rivera, and the colleagues behind the scenes, some of which we have here today. Colleagues like Freddy Rolón, Rodolfo Martinez, Michelle Vela, Wendell Scott, Ibelka Fernandez, Jennifer Altarriba, Calu Rodriguez, Sonia Gomez. All of those are here today. Could you stand up for a minute? Thank you. So at ESPN, diversity is about who's on the team, and inclusion is about who gets to play. We say this with certainty because at the diversity and inclusion and wellness survey that we conducted last fall, 93% of our employees indicated that diversity adds value to our business, and 90% of our employees said that ESPN values diversity. Those are astonishing numbers that even we were surprised to see. But for those of my colleagues in HR, we don't get reports on the 90%. That's very unique. So we feel very proud about that. The most recent report of the Institute of Diversity and Ethics, TIDES, headed by Dr. Richard Lapchick, also indicate that ESPN is a leader in the hiring of women and people of color in key positions. Of the 16 people of color who are sports editors at this level, 7 work for ESPN. Of the 11 women who are sports editors at this level, 7 work for ESPN. Of the 48 men of color who were columnists at the top newspapers and websites, 41 work for ESPN. And of the 37 women who are columnists at this level, 32 work for ESPN. So clearly, we all have a lot to do. Clearly, we all have an opportunity to increase those numbers and reach our audience in a more compelling way. But that being said, at ESPN, we feel proud that not only the people in front of the camera and behind the camera, but also the leadership of our company reflects that diversity. In 2015, we achieved some historic milestones. We now have more female executive vice presidents and vice presidents than ever before in the history of our company. We now have more minority senior VPs and managers than ever before in the history of our company. So we are absolutely proud of our accomplishments, but we are also relentless in our commitment to diversity and inclusion. Part of the commitment to our Hispanic fans is the very reason we bring to you this panel. ESPN and the Walt Disney Company feel extremely proud of our partnership with HACR because we share a deep commitment to advance Hispanic inclusion. Diversity and inclusion are profoundly ingrained in our day-to-day business, and we understand the importance of reaching this audience to serve our Hispanic fans anytime, anywhere. But because una imagen habla más que mil palabras, let's just see a sample of the work that we do every day that we feel so happy that we have the opportunity to serve our sports fans, and let's just show you how that looks like. Da-na-na, da-na-na.
Glad you can join us here for One Nación.
Serving sports fans in English y en español.
ESPN Deportes in Mexico is set to debut their new sports center look today.
A day that we are more than happy to share with the audience in the United States.
A lo profundo! No, 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 no! Díganle que no está pelota!
listen, whether you speak English or Spanish and you watch ESPN, you've heard no, 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 no.
Le quita el balón y es un touchdown, Denver.
Touchdown, touchdown. Angelique Kerber es campeona de Australia.
What up? I'm Danny Carales and this is No Hablo Español.
I'm 100% Mexican, 100% American.
Most of us feel like we're a guest in this country when really, you know, this is our home.
You know, we should be, you know, one.
Un amigo, una gran persona. Mike Greenberg, the Mike and Mike in the morning.
Porque el gordo aquí no sabe nada.
Called me fat, didn't he?
He did, yeah.
My Nation Initiative was an initiative that was created to serve Hispanics. We wanted an initiative in which we could mix languages. By creating One Nación, we were able to accomplish all this.
We're serving the bilingual fan in a way that encapsulates what we do in Spanish and brings together what we do in English.
Pa, pa, y al cuerpo.
These are fans who are younger. They're fans who are more mobile. They're fans who expect more. We're the place that can deliver that.
The standard was set very high last year with our special. We were a national trending topic on Twitter.
We truly were trying to serve the Hispanic fan in both languages across all platforms.
This year's ESPN One Nación TV special theme is pride, the pride of our favorite sports, teams, athletes, culture, heritage.
I feel so proud to be a Latina.
It's a beautiful thing, man. I was very proudful of my culture.
Serving sport fans in English.
Yes, bye.
Okay. So without further ado, I appreciate you being here today, and let's talk about sports.
Again, on behalf of HACR ESPN, thank you so much for helping us move our mission forward. So if you haven't seen him around the hallways, you've seen him a few times up on the screen. Our moderator today is Max Barretos, who works with ESPN. He joined in 2010, appearing on SportsCenter. Anyone see SportsCenter here? He's also worked on College Football Live, MMA Live, Outside the Lines, and College Basketball Raps. Barretos is also a premier voice for soccer on ESPN networks, serving as lead anchor for the MLS Cup and appearing on ESPN's Euro 2012. Before ESPN, Barretos worked for Fox Soccer Channel, Fox Sports World. A native of Miami, Barretos is the son of Cuban exiles and is a member of the National Association of Hispanic Journalists. Please welcome Max Barretos.
It's a big stack of papers. It's just for safety, really. I only need one. It's interesting with regards to diversity and inclusion. I always think about my when I told my family in Miami that I was going to start working at ESPN, my tío Pepito, who always tries to get a rise out of me. And he's like, I come up and I go, hey, he's like, you work for ESPN? I go, yeah. He goes, estoy enfermo de Alabama y Nick Saban. Puedo tener un poquito de Miami Dolphins. Y también me interesa el NASCAR. I'm like, wow, I didn't know that, tío Pepito, but okay, we'll see what we can do. But I remember when he said that, and I go, everyone has their own, everyone wants to see what's theirs on SportsCenter, but it makes it a great show where we bring it all together, and I'm very proud to work on it. When I first started in 2010, I was a very quiet partner with regards to that. Just to give you a little background, with SportsCenter, every SportsCenter show you have, we have a meeting. And you have the producer, the coordinating producer, the director, the graphics producer, you have the researchers, you have the anchors, and they talk about what they want on the show. Generally, you say, okay, say it's the day of the Super Bowl. We have the Super Bowl on. We're going to start with the Super Bowl. We're going to have a little bit about NBA, et cetera. Everyone's encouraged to voice what they think is important. And through the years, and more so that I've been a little empowered, thanks to things like One Nación, where in addition I work with Miley Rivera, and we have a podcast where we get to be the voice of the Hispanic audience, to be the voice at times of the Hispanic athlete. In those meetings, I get to say, you know what? Yasiel Puig is batting 400. We should talk about him. We talk about the Hispanic, the stories that are important to the Hispanic community, and we put it into the big show that SportsCenter, which really is a microcosm of the United States. So with that, and folks like Antonieta Collins, Serena Morales in SportsCenter, folks like Dan Le Batard, who has his own show on radio and TV, we've been able to push that agenda to be inclusive, but not to exclude the rest of the audience, and to maybe people learn a little bit along the way. I know in 2016, it's been a thrill to work on an incredible amount of things to show that ESPN and SportsCenter is moving in the right direction with that. I know with the Super Bowl, it's Super Bowl 50, ESPN Deportes got to cover it. To see ESPN and ESPN Deportes kind of come together and use their resources was fantastic. A couple months ago, the Tampa Bay Rays went to Cuba. I don't know if you got to see any of that coverage, but they came all to us and goes, is there anyone here who's Cuban? And like six hands went up. And I was like, this is incredible, because we had Dan Le Batard, George Sedano, myself, Pedro Gomez, Eduardo Perez, who coaches the Marlins, and went down there. So some folks were in Cuba, and we and our leaders in our company said, how do we tackle this? And we said, we can go to Cuba, and you can present the game as is. But we need to be in Miami, too, because the Cuban exile community, we got to give them a voice. And we did, and I was really proud of what was happening. Tomorrow I'm actually working on a podcast with Mali Rivera. We're going to have Claudio Trejos as well as Bernardo Osuna to preview Canelo Amir Khan. Anyone going to watch that? Anyone? Yeah? This something wouldn't happen before. Now you have a Cubano, a Boricua, a Colombiano, and a Mexicano talking about the fight. That's pretty awesome. All right, enough about me. We have a very exciting conversation here. I'm excited about the panel we have, and I think we're going to roll up the sleeves here and get to the issues about diversity and inclusion and how to cater to the Hispanic market in whole. This is a priority for ESPN in particular. I know it is for the members of our panel as well that represent some of the heavy hitters in sports across the United States and the world for that matter. So I'm going to bring them up here. We're going to start the discussion. They're going to introduce themselves so our five panelists could join me here. Tom Cordova, who is a sports marketing consultant and president of Cordova Marketing. Orris Stewart, who is the Senior Vice President, Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer of the NBA. I'm going to introduce them, and they're going to say a little bit more about what they do. Donna Gordon, Director in Diversity of Inclusion of the USTA, the United States Tennis Association, and Rene Tirado, of Senior Director of Major League Baseball, to join me here. So let's give them a little hand. I'm sure they have a good Tio Pepito story as well, if needs be. Michelle Bell as well, who works with me at ESPN. I don't know if I said that.
I can introduce myself. Michelle Bell, ESPN, VP of Marketing.
Well, actually, while we have you, if you could start us up here, and then if everyone can, let's just do a quick introduction as we get into our discussion. I will remind you also that we'll open it up to questions a little bit later. And at the end of it all, it might be a little surprise for some of you in this room, so I would encourage you to sit and enjoy it for the duration. So, Michelle, let's start with you.
Yeah, so I've got such a great gig at ESPN. Always thankful to wake up and do this because it's so much fun. Been at ESPN for about 8 years now, doing marketing for the Hispanic audience. So whether it's Spanish-dominant Hispanics on ESPN Deportes or against the bilingual and English audience on ESPN, that's what we do with the team.
Donna at the end.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Donna Dozier Gordon, as Max said, and I'm Director of Diversity and Inclusion for the U.S. Tennis Association. In that capacity, I'm responsible primarily for supplier diversity, but I also have oversight of our business resource groups, which is what we call our employee resource groups, as well as responsibility for our external relationships with strategic partners.
Tom.
Hi, Tom Cordova. I'm a Hispanic coal miner's grandson who's been fortunate to work in sports for the last 35 years, and I literally have worked with all of the properties here. This is really amazing. Thank you very much, Sid, for making this happen. Of course, to ESPN, got to give them a huge shout out. When they had their first One Nacion special, my wife was wondering what the screaming was. That was one of the biggest moments in the history of sports, when Spanish met English and it was woven together. Thanks, ESPN.
That's a great answer, by the way, Tom. We like that. Renee.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Renee Tirado. I am the Senior Director of Recruitment for Major League Baseball. I am an attorney by trade. Please do not hold it against me. Prior to joining Major League Baseball, I've been here approximately 2 months, but prior to joining Major League Baseball, I led diversity and inclusion for the Americas for AIG. Before that, I was at the USTA, and before that, I was with the NBA Retired Players Association.
Good afternoon. I'm Oris Stewart, Senior Vice President and Chief Diversity Officer for the NBA. My responsibility includes the NBA, the WNBA, and our development league, the D League. And so I cover all aspects of the business that have implications or that touch the topics of diversity and inclusion, and that includes our supply chain, our community engagement, our talent, and of course our marketplace. And just in terms of diversity, I happen to be an electrical engineer and an MBA by background, and here I am in the diversity and inclusion space, which I think just speaks to the power of diversity in this work.
We're thrilled to have the panelists. You see, we have a very diverse group here. They can speak on a lot of fronts, and with regards to recruitment, diversity and inclusion, obviously, and catering to the Hispanic audience, we're gonna jump right into it, and I'll open up the questions, and then again, we will get you guys involved as the afternoon continues here. So I'll start here at the end with Donna, and the rest of you can chime in here. Talk to us about where you were and where you are today with the efforts in catering to Hispanic market and marketplace.
U.S. Tennis Association has had a formal commitment to diversity and inclusion for about a dozen years. But we started our journey probably about two decades ago, and we did something that we called multicultural participation. And that was led by a gentleman by the name of D.A. Abrams, who is currently our Chief Diversity Officer. Today, we have a holistic D&I strategy that includes many of the elements that you would find in a corporate diversity program, including human assets or talent, image, or making sure that our communication touch points indicate that the sport is welcoming, supplier diversity, as I mentioned, community involvement, strategic partnerships, and training and development. And I think in terms of where we were and where we are now and kind of what we learned along the way, I think initially, like many organizations, our focus was on the numbers, compliance around diversity, and we've transitioned to diversity being a driver of business success. So, in fact, our department is really positioned as internal consultants to the rest of the organization. So, instead of saying, this is what we need you to do, we meet with department leaders to say, what are your business challenges? And how can we marry those challenges with diversity-related solutions?
Michelle?
So I have to start with ESPN's mission, which is to serve all sports fans anytime, anywhere. And that's something that we live and breathe. And diversity is really a key component of that. It just, you know, it's part of the DNA. It's part of our culture. And we're really proud of that. ESPN Deportes started out in 2004, so 12 years ago. The company saw that there was a solid business to start a Spanish language television network dedicated to Spanish dominant Hispanics. Over those past 12 years, the company has invested in ESPN Deportes. And right now we've got a radio network, we've got radio affiliates, we've got an app, we've got a site. I mean, it's turned into a robust social following. We've got a very strong business for ESPN Deportes. And we see ourselves now as the country has shifted, right, with less immigration, more U.S. Hispanic births. All of that means that the audience has shifted a little bit. If you take a look at the audience, it sort of breaks out into thirds. A third Spanish dominant, a third English dominant, and a third bilingual. And so really where the opportunity we see going forward is in this bilingual mix, the two-thirds of that audience going forward. So now it's in our best interest to make sure that ESPN Deportes is a very strong business and continues to be, so that we can act as an on-ramp into the ESPN brands and all of the platforms that we have. And so going back to what you were saying, we are now being tapped, our marketing teams, as consultants within the general market team. In fact, we've all shifted in terms organizationally under the general market team, marketing team, so that we can help with the sports that matter, NBA, NFL. I mean, we've done so much research here, and now folks are coming to us, and it's really a privilege for us to be able to do that because the organization and the leadership sees, and the numbers tell us that this is a path to growth for us.
That's where it should be, and we look forward to that. By the way, Fernando Palomo of ESPN Deportes is kind of my equivalent. He has 1 million Twitter followers. I have 30,000. So you guys are doing a great job with that, engaging with the audience as well. I get a few tips from him anyway. Let's continue here with Tom Cordova.
I'm an agent of change. And I've been very methodical over the last 3 decades, actually it was close to 40 years in professional sports, methodically learning about broadcasting, sales, every different piece of the sports equation. And the thing that has occurred to me is that it really is about culture. Now, all of you sitting out there know the way to reach Hispanics is by being in culture. There is a mirror image to that, and that's the organizations themselves. The only way that you can really successfully reach Hispanics is if you have a similar kind of culture. You have to understand, you have to feel it in your bones what Hispanics need, what they feel, what they aspire to, what's going on their hearts, their struggles. And so all of that together, being able to spread that across organizations is the recipe for being successful in sports when it comes to not only African-Americans, Hispanics, Asian-Americans.
Oris, because of just the 2 months that Renee's been involved with Major League Baseball, we'll skip to Oris, we'll get back to her on the next question. But Oris, that same question to the others. Talk to us about where you were and where you are today with your handlings in the NBA.
Sure, you know, the NBA has been focused on this topic or thinking about it or practicing diversity and inclusion for quite some time. Largely the outcome of the product we put on the court, it represents a host of communities that's increasingly global. If you look at our players today, a quarter of our players, 100 of our players are from born outside of the U.S. And so, you know, the game has been increasingly a diverse game on the court, in the arena for some time. But what I'd say has really evolved for us is, as we look back, we thought about, like many organizations, we thought about the marketplace in a segmented construct, a segmented context. And so we built a platform called NABA many years ago, which was a Spanish language platform focused on delivering our content to Hispanic consumer. It's a segmented approach. What we've evolved to, though, is recognizing that our fans and our guests and our customers are largely Hispanic and minority and young. And so we have integrated our mainstream approach, we've integrated the Hispanic conversation into our mainstream approach. We built a foundation that we believe is inclusive of all of our fans. And then we overlay that with NABA and other products and other properties. And so I think it's gotten more sophisticated, more nuanced. And we think about the Hispanic marketplace and the broad marketplace being inclusive of Hispanics. We don't think about the Hispanic marketplace differently in the way that we used to.
Monica didn't mention it at the beginning, but the soon-to-be NBA Rookie of the Year, or if you correct me if I'm wrong with the guests, but Karl Anthony Towns, Dominican mom. So it just goes to show the reach of Hispanic, not only participating, but as well as Oris was touching on, the consumers, the viewers of the NBA. It's a huge sport in the Hispanic community. With regards to that first question, we'll follow up now on what have you learned in the process? We'll start again with Donna.
Well, I tried to touch on that a little bit in my first answer, but again, we had a very numbers-driven approach initially, and we learned that that really doesn't work. If you want sustainable change in an organization, I think you have to amplify what diversity does actually to improve the business. This is not something that we do because it's a nice thing to do. It really has impact on the business ultimately. And so our focus has shifted to be looking at diversity as a driver of the business.
So a lot of times you put a dollar amount on this. Before, as you touched on, it was for the inclusion purposes, but this Hispanic market is huge. And I know our superiors at ESPN have made it abundantly clear, and that is a big part of what we move forward. I know, Michelle, we can touch on some of the challenges that you have learned in the process of Kate.
Well, I think you really have to make research your friend. You have to have so many insights into the fandom in general, right? So we really start with asking the questions. What are the sports for bilingual fans? Who are the favorite athletes? Is it Messi, Ronaldo, Jordan, Kobe? Favorite teams, Barcelona, Dallas Cowboys, Lakers. What are the studio shows with the highest composition of Hispanics as part of the interruption? First Take, highly questionable. And so the more questions that you start asking as you start to target this market, that will help you guide the way, and it'll also help sort of get some the nuances that you need to attract and retain the audience. I mean, where is the media that they're consuming? How much time are they spending? So to me, having a very strong insights and research team that helps illuminate the way for you so that when you, so that you're making smart decisions along the way, that to me is super key. Of course, we have the, you know, we're blessed too that we've got Hispanic talent in front of the camera too, so it's fantastic to have that representation, which has been growing over the past couple of years, to be able to have a fan say, hey, I can relate to Max, I know her, I know him. So I think that that's also something that's very important in the mix.
It's good to hear. Tom?
I think it's critical to invest in understanding Hispanics. Let's face it, we're all in the pro sports industry right here, and we all have to go up to the biggest cheeses and beg for money. Research is something that pro sports generally has not done in the past. It's only as a result of years of hammering away saying, we need to get to know our audience, that we get to get some of those precious dollars. And it's a matter of breaking down this institutional arrogance. It is difficult to break into professional sports. All of us are so lucky to have our jobs. There are so many barriers to entry. So it's a matter of knocking those doors down, and I have to hand it to all my fellow panelists here, because these guys are the pioneers. They're the ones who are making it happen so that the big leagues are the leagues for everybody. So it's a matter of investing and continuing to invest and opening the doors.
Morris?
You know, I think what we've learned and what we're still learning is that we've got to move beyond diversity, particularly diversity in a traditional sense. But we've got to move to inclusion. I like to say, think about the I before the D. because if we continue to focus on diversity, we keep focusing on diversity. But I believe as we focus more on inclusion, diversity will take care of itself. I like to think of us moving from having a diversity reflex to having an inclusion instinct. And not be reactive to things and say, well, we've got to do something because this happened. But to naturally think about all of our consumers and all and the marketplace for talent and the broad supplier community and naturally include them in everything we do. Because that ultimately drives innovation, that grows the game, that is sustainable. And so for us, and we're still learning that, don't get me wrong. I mean, we really have to push that. But I really do believe we've got to still focus on the D, but I think we've got to focus and push on the I as much as, if not more so, even than the D.
Oris, you just coined a wonderful new expression, which I will be using with some regularity. Put the I before the D. So let's put the I before the D. Let's hit the next question. Let's talk to Rene Tirado of Major League Baseball. And what is the biggest opportunities for Hispanic inclusion in your eyes?
Really? That's going to be the easy question? there are a ton of opportunities. I know from a Major League Baseball point of view, the biggest thing that's happening right now is everything is around really understanding the online, digital, Latino consumer. As many of you probably know at this point, Latinos, people in color in general, but Latinos in particular, significantly over-index in social media, and it is the low-hanging fruit for us in terms of having a huge platform to capture and engage a very broad audience in a very quick way. The other opportunities are that the fact is that the business case has finally been acknowledged around diversity and inclusion, particularly the inclusion component. I'm hearing more and more, especially at Major League Baseball and at other organizations, understanding that this is not a feel-good agenda. This is necessary to our economic survival and growth. This has to be done. We have to start to include the Latino perspective, not only from the fan base, but also from the business, and bringing in that talent to continue to provide that thinking to help us remain competitive in this space.
Very well put. And I know most of us in this room are Hispanic, and that is a wonderful message to convey to our bosses, to our superiors, to our colleagues, to let them know this is the moment, this is the line in the sand moment that we really have to include with the Hispanic community as part of the bigger picture with everything we do on a day-to-day basis. Donna, the same question for you. What are the biggest opportunities for Hispanic inclusion?
The opportunities are many, and some of them are born out of challenges in engaging the community. So USTA is, as you may know, the national governing body for the sport of tennis. And so that makes us a little bit different than my colleagues in the NBA or MLB, in that we have the professional tennis side, but we also have a focus on recreational tennis. And our mission really is to promote and develop the growth of the sport. We have a tagline, find yourself in the game, right? Seems like that should be a pretty universal message. But I think one of the challenges is if people do not see themselves in the game, why would they want to participate? And when I think about the Hispanic community in particular, the lack of visible role models or the lack of access to role models is probably a barrier to our engagement efforts and kind of led to some strategies, which I'll talk about in a minute. So if you're an avid tennis fan, you probably know about pioneers like Pancho Gonzalez and Rosie Casals, and you may know about more recent players like Mary Jo Fernandez and Gigi Fernandez, or even emerging players like Christina McHale. But when I think about young people, and young people are really the pipeline for us, we know that if kids pick up a tennis racket, they're more likely to adopt tennis as a sport for a lifetime. For young people, I don't know that they're aware of those role models in the same way that they might be a J.J. Barea or Francisco Garcia from the NBA. So that creates a challenge. The lack of facilities that are in proximity or in heavily Hispanic communities where people can play tennis.
How does diversity drive business results and success at your organization?
Well, every rating point at ESPN is important for us. It drives profit. And we know, so you have to pardon the paperwork because there's a lot of data here, but it's stuff that we're really, really proud of. Multicultural audiences are driving ESPN's ratings growth. So check this out. In the 4 weeks into 2016, the second quarter of 2016, so we're talking about as of last Friday, ESPN is up plus 4% again against persons 18 to 49. So the growth is good, right? When you take a look at 4%. That's why you have to have your research team and intel and data behind you. Okay, but let's go deeper into that 4%. What is that made up of? Okay, non-Hispanic white ratings were flat to last year. Non-Hispanic black ratings were up 8%. Hispanic ratings up 27% year over year. And English dominant Hispanics ratings are up 35% year over year. So it's clearly the multicultural audience that's driving that ratings growth in Q2 so far. And the ratings, this rating success isn't just, it's across the board. It's against studio and events. So our daily studio shows like SportsCenter, it's up 25% year over year with Hispanics. And major events are up as well. So the NBA regular season finished up 37% among Hispanic persons 18 to 49. The NBA playoffs are up plus 17%. And season to date, Sunday Night Baseball is up 21% year over year. So why do I bring all of this to your attention? Because, again, going back to this, if you're measuring it and you've got these kinds of numbers, the executive suite will start paying attention to this. And they'll devote more resources to this and say, we've got, this is a path to growth. Everyone should be paying attention to this. It becomes a company priority, and this kind of stuff galvanizes the organization. So whether you're in marketing or production or programming or whatever, everyone finds a way to chip in to do this stuff. So I would say, you know, you have to track it, you have to measure it, because if you can't measure it, you can't see sort of the progress that you're making. It yields a commitment from the top, and it really trickles down across the entire organization.
Eye-opening numbers, and I know they're paying attention, and that's a, it's great criteria we could bring to them. Tom, to follow up on that?
Well, piggybacking on what the USDA is doing, you know, Hispanic marketing used to be that. It was just some incremental act. It wasn't a fully holistic program. You need to do something that affects everybody from the janitor to the C-suite, because if you're doing it properly, everybody's involved. You're getting the right kind of employees, you're talking to the right kind of suppliers, you're talking to the top executives, you're bringing all those folks into your organization. Incrementality kills organizations. The holistic approach from the very top to the very bottom is essential. It's just, the parallel here is customer service. If the big cheese isn't doing it, the rest of the organization is going to follow suit, and you're just going to be less effective than you could be.
I think there's also, from a Major League Baseball point of view, I mean, Hispanic inclusion is going to be integral to our growth, and it's also about thinking about outside the box. You know, I was actually very happy to hear about our clubs being very, very creative around how they are trying to engage new fans into their world. For example, the Arizona Diamondbacks last year, and they're repeating it this year due to its tremendous success, said, hey, how do we start to get more fans to engage and participate in baseball? And they said, well, we know that the Latinos in our community are huge soccer fans. So they basically partnered with a local television station to showcase a huge match that was happening in FIFA on the grounds of the stadium during a game. So while there was a game going on inside, there were thousands and thousands of Latino fans participating in baseball via soccer. Why? And then some people are like, well, that doesn't make sense. They weren't in the seats, but actually it did, because we captured a tremendous amount of data. We were tracking Twitter, we were tracking social media, we captured emails and telephone numbers and information that now the clubs were able to target those groups and that information to drive ticket sales for future promotions. And it's been hugely successful for us. And other teams are going to start duplicating that. So that's the power of where inclusion, Hispanic inclusion, really can drive the business.
The success stories are plentiful out there, and certainly worth imitating, duplicating throughout everything we do. And Renee, I want to follow up on you as you talked about engaging those Hispanic fans. But what is your organization do to recruit and develop a pipeline of Hispanic talent within Major League Baseball, certainly within players, within filling the coffers for your organization as well?
Well, one of the things I do want to say, obviously I'm leading recruitment for Major League Baseball right now, but this is not new for Major League Baseball. This has been something that's been a part of MLB's DNA for many, many years. It's a marathon, not a race, and that's indicative of the fact that Major League Baseball was the first sports entity to have a dedicated diversity and inclusion department. And that was led by Wendy Lewis, who is sitting here. She's been with Major League Baseball for 30 years. Even before she started leading D&I, she was a part of this conversation. And we have been doing this, and this is a part of our DNA. In addition to that, Wendy started a diversity business summit that has been going on for several years, that includes a job fair where we invite all 30 clubs to come in and interface with diverse candidates for jobs at the clubs and at the commissioner's office. And now, through Wendy's leadership and the leadership of Commissioner Manfred, they did hire someone like me, who was a little bit, I call it, outside the lines. It would have been very easy to hire a corporate talent acquisition person, but it was very deliberate in their thinking to bring somebody with a diversity and inclusion background, so you start to embed the inclusion in the business. And with that, we have started to engage and talk to different audiences in a much broader way. But one of the things that the commissioner and Wendy have started at Major League Baseball is a front office and field staff diversity pipeline program that's being led by Tyrone Brooks in collaboration with my department, the recruitment department. And it's a two-pronged approach. It is focusing on entry-level internships, to bring in diverse talent at that junior level. And going forward, part of that program will be having the clubs have hiring targets that they will have to match. And then the other part of it is collaborating with Tyrone, myself, the diversity department, to identify existing major league, existing employees in MLB who are considered high potential talent, diverse existing employees, and really working with the clubs to help them craft and create legitimate career development plans so we can start building a pipeline for our future GMs, AGMs, managers, and on the staff, on the field, talent. In addition, some of the things that we're doing tactically at Major League Baseball, which may not sound like a big deal, but it is for us, is we recently started a pilot program that I'm really happy to say where we're redacting identifying information from resumes because it really should just be about the talent. You don't need to know what their name is, what school they went to, you know, what organizations that may say that they're a woman or Latino. That shouldn't come into play as much. It should really focus on what your experience is. My team is tracking the candidates. We're putting out the diverse candidates out there with that information redacted, and we've already had success with it where we're getting more Latino candidates to get interviews that may not have gotten a second look just based on necessarily the school that they went to, because there is that inherent bias in what they're, you know, some hiring managers are involved in. In addition, we're working very closely with our clients on workforce planning. Again, another pilot that we have going on there is that we are getting certain leadership in baseball ops and our international division who have agreed and committed to start looking at talent outside of the sports industry, looking at people with different backgrounds to participate in baseball with a very strong transferable skill set. And those are just some of the things that we're doing. But I also wanted to add that we've been doing this again for a long time. Major League Baseball predated the Rooney Rule by 3 years. We were doing the C-League Rule requiring a diverse slate of talent to participate in any hiring program. So it was very important that we have some context around where MLB is doing this. And I'm very, very proud of what we're doing. And there's more to come. Stay tuned. This is new. But Major League Baseball is thoroughly committed to this program and developing talent.
That is great to hear. Great to hear. Let's talk to Orris now. And I'm going to combine a couple questions for you, Orris. What do you want participants to know about your organization's diversity and inclusion efforts, or inclusion and diversity efforts? And what's next on the horizon?
Well, let me start by acknowledging the history that MLB has established, the legacy they've established under Wendy's leadership and now Renee's and many others. It really is something to recognize and appreciate. At the NBA, interestingly, I'm the first chief diversity officer. And so Wendy's been there for 30 years, maybe in that role a little bit less. I am the first, and I've been there for less than a year. And so it's a relatively new function, at least formally. But we're very proud of the fact that, and Monica referred to the Lapchick report, the race and gender report card, and we have for the last 7 years received a grade of an A in terms of our overall grade on racial and gender diversity. And so we're very proud of our history. But as I got there just about a year ago, really the question is, what's next for us and where should we be focused? And I'll just mention a couple of things. You heard me talk about focusing on the I before the D, and you see it up here on the placards at the banners at the front of the room. Well, here's what we really mean by that. You know, when we have historically focused on diversity in just a race and gender sense, it is in many respects is self-limiting. And ultimately, the diversity that drives business results, in my opinion, in my experience over 16 plus years, is cognitive diversity. Diversity of thinking, diversity of experience, diversity of approach. And so we thought it was important to really focus much more on what I would call capital D, a much broader definition. Many of you have children. My children don't think of themselves in the context of diversity the way I did. And so for us to engage the millennial candidates for work, for us to engage our fans, we've got to think about it more broadly. And so we decided we're going to define it more broadly. But here's the trick. It's not either demographic diversity or cognitive diversity. It's both. And here's how they relate to each other. Cognitive diversity is often rooted in demographic diversity. Mm-hmm. It's often informed by demographic diversity. So for us, in our pursuit of cognitive diversity, you know, we recognize that demographic diversity is a proxy for, or it's the leading indicator. So we are striving for inclusion and striving for cognitive diversity, recognizing that demographic diversity is a path there. It is a proxy for. And so in that respect, you know, we are taking the whole organization through a series of learning experiences to help them to think about the connection between innovation and diversity, and recognize that sometimes you want to purposefully bring together people who are different with different backgrounds to tackle a problem, because the more different they are, the more challenge they may have working through that problem, but the more likelihood there's going to be some breakthrough that other folks couldn't reach, a level of achievement that other folks couldn't reach. And so we're really focusing on driving breakthrough so that we don't keep doing the things we've been doing, but just incrementally better. We want to grow the game. We are growing the game. We want to push it to its global limits and boundaries. And so we need to really bring together people with very different backgrounds, very different perspectives, and that includes the traditional definitions of diversity, but a much broader set as well. And then, of course, where inclusion comes in, and why we're taking the entire organization through learning experiences around unconscious bias and inclusive leadership, is because if we don't have inclusion culturally at the league level and at our teams, then as we bring this diverse talent in, they will not stay. Or if they stay, they will not perform. They will not be able to contribute to their fullest capacity. And so we are very, very keenly focused on driving a new culture at our organizations, at the league office and at the teams. And we are looking, my last comment is, we're looking to think about inclusion and diversity in a 360 around the organization. I said this earlier, it's about talent, diverse talent in all of its dimensions. It's about our guests and our fans in the arena, and those, most of our fans will never get to an arena. Most of them will consume the game on a flat screen, or most, even more so, on a mobile device. It's about our community engagement and strategically picking organizations that are going to help us achieve our ambitions. And ultimately, it's about our supply chain. Again, I credit MLB for what they've done over many years in terms of expanding the group of suppliers they do work with. We're doing the same thing and making sure that we inclusively and instinctively think about a diverse set of suppliers that are, in their own right, going to bring innovation into, you know, how we deliver the game to our fans. So, you know, those are the kind of things we're working on.
I laughed a little at Oris because I was telling him about, I feel old every time I turn on a television now because all the kids are, you know, like, anyway. Stay with your TVs. They're getting really big and the HD is off the charts. And watch ESPN if you're there. We want to open up to questions for the panel. This is a big job, everybody, and we want to get all the feedback we can get. We know we can do a lot of great work within here, and we can spread the word out. There's a couple of microphones they pointed out on each. I feel like a steward for American Airlines.
Tom wants to say something.
Max, if I could interrupt.
Oh, sure, sure.
It's to sum up, in a sense, what our mission is, and that's to listen to you. This is my, I think, 19th symposium. And I have learned from many of you, there's a lot of familiar faces in the audience. And I know what it's like being in the big leagues. You get bombarded by all sorts of requests. And inevitably, it's, oh, they just want a handout from us. It's a direct opposite. If we need to know what are in people's hearts, it is by getting together and doing things in the community, like with Aspira, like Mana, like LULAC. It's by talking to people like Robert Bard, who has Latina style. Who doesn't want Hispanic women to participate?
Top of the list.
And so, we want to keep learning from you and come up to us, tell us your opinions, and you have to keep at it, because the barriers to entry are formidable, but the prize is there. And the end result will be something that brings everybody together, especially right now. Lord knows the country is divided enough. Sports can be the tonic, can be the elixir that brings everybody together. And the next thing you know, the stands will look. I mean, the stadium, whether it's NASCAR, whether it's the US Open, whether it's Major League Baseball, you'll see a little bit more color in the crowd, because the bottom line is all the season ticket holders are dying. And it's time, it's the truth. And it's time to get going with the new world.
There's a pick-me-up on the way out. That was awesome, Tom. I appreciate that. Any questions? A great opportunity to speak to people involved in some of the biggest sports organizations, the biggest sports organizations in the world, and get their feedback on diversity and inclusion.
Thank you, Tom, for the shout-out. I have a question that is on the role that sports plays in our society. And every day in the news somewhere, we hear about a professional athlete doing something that is totally negative and reflects on the sports and reflects actually on our society. So I'm really interested in finding out, okay, let's say the Major League Baseball. When a kid gets drafted into a major league team, is there an orientation that is given to them as what is expected for them in our communities and in our society? And why isn't it mandatory when you draft a player to tell them you have to spend so many days in schools talking to kids?
So to your first part of your question, yes, there is an orientation program that we participate in and partner with the Players Association around giving them the best practices. I know the NBA, the NFL, all of the leagues do this. It's a player orientation program to talk to them about how to handle media, everything from how to handle their finances and the media to handle groupies and women and bad behavior. All of that is done and exposed, but you can't compel that behavior. You can only give them the tools, the resources, and support to let them know that we're there to help them navigate this new world with regard to not forcing them, but having mandatory appearances, things of that nature. There is some of that built in, but again, these are independent contractors. I mean, they have their unions that have to dictate those terms. The leagues focus on actually representing the interests of the teams and owners. And yes, we want to manage as much as we're possible our brand, and the players are inherently tied to that brand, but we can only dictate but so much. What we can do is lead by example and continue to give them the tools and support, which we provide a significant amount to our players on how to navigate the world of professional sports. But at the end of the day, they are their own person and they're going to make their own decisions. We can only hold them accountable so much, but there is a bar and there are morals clauses in all of their contracts requiring them to behave a certain way. And we're very, very diligent on managing those behaviors with the tools that we have in place.
I think ESPN on that front takes the long view that sport is something that unites everybody. And if we're good at marketing sports, it's about togethering and the celebration and talking about the stories of the struggles of getting from point A to incredible stardom. And as much as we can showcase that and tell these stories and even talk about the recovery road in situations like that, I think that that's really, again, we're looking for the positive in all of this stuff. And yes, we have a responsibility to report on something journalistically that has gone awry. But I think that on the flip side, through everything else that we do, the point here is to celebrate sort of what unites, what sport is all about. It's passion and family and food and celebration and getting together and all of that beautiful stuff that we, on the marketing side, really try to showcase. It's supportive every day.
And let me just add to that, our players do quite a bit, all of our players do quite a bit in the community, but it may not always be captured by the ESPN or the local media, but they are significantly involved. And I just, from my personal experience in other sports, what I've seen is I found that Major League Baseball players are doing quite a bit more than a lot of their counterparts, but the exposure is not there and they don't want that exposure. They're not doing it to get credit. They're doing it because they legitimately want to stay involved in the community, stay connected, and let people know that they care. But it's not about necessarily having an appearance being required of them. It's part of what they want to do as individuals.
Because some feel that it undermines the act of kindness
if
you're out there and mugging for the camera.
Right, it's about the credibility. They don't want credit for this. They want to do this because it's a part of their DNA.
But you know, all the spikes that you see in sports, I played rugby for a living in a previous life, not in this country, but in Europe.
15-year rugby player, best sport participation-wise.
Anyway. Rugger. So what we see is that when you have a superstar, like in tennis, for instance, when you had Gigi Fernandez or you have any major Latina, because my world is basically Latina, when you have a major Latina or Helen Ochoa for golf that came to the forefront, the impact that they had in their community and in the schools, not only with young Latina girls, but with girls in general, was enormous. So I apologize, but I just feel that the stories that get out, maybe ESPN, you know, you need to force more of the positive stories every day. Instead of for us to see all these horrendous stories that come out every day about, you know, professional sports. Thank you.
Thank you. We have 5 minutes, so let's try to get as many questions
Great,
as we can.
Great question. My name is Andre Arbeles. I'm from Detroit, home of the Triple Crown winner Miguel Cabrera, and current batting champ Nick Castellanos, and with one of two cities that has a Latin general manager, Al Avila. My question across the board for NBA, Major League Baseball, and USTA, at your level and above, how many Hispanics are in the front office?
Not enough.
Yeah. There's a number. Do you know?
There is. Actually, I don't know. I don't want to mislead you and say what the number is. And I'm not sure what the number is. But that is specifically why we created the Diversity Pipeline Program, because we do know that there is a gap. And we're working on it diligently by hiring staff that's just focused exclusively on developing entry level and existing high potential diverse talent within MLB to be the future leaders of our organizations.
I think the specific answer to your question comes from Richard Lapchick and University of Central Florida. Monica, you were referring to that before?
But I'm looking for specific answers. At Major League, you know, in the NBA, now that we're seeing a rise of the Hispanics, you know, coming in play, as Monica mentioned, are there Hispanics in the front office?
There certainly are, and again, I think the Lapchick report would be able to refer to
how
the
come
statistics.
You guys don't know?
I do know, not only at the league office, but at the teams as well. But I think the point is there aren't enough, and there are very directed efforts and concentrated efforts, similar to what Renee talked about, that are underway at the NBA as well. I do think clearly we're doing better at the league office than we are at our teams, but not enough.
Yeah. And I will gladly follow up with you to get you that information.
And the purpose of the Hispanic Association of Corporate Responsibility is to make sure we hold you accountable.
Right.
That's why the question I think is very fair.
Sure.
What about at the USTA?
I would just add that we have quite a number of Hispanics in our workforce. Our senior HR leader is Latino. Our recruiter is Latina. And, you know, as my panelists have indicated, my fellow panelists, there's a lot more that we know that we could be doing to create pipelines. So, for example, we're in the process now of building a major facility in Orlando, Florida. And given the importance of the Hispanic market in that area, targeted recruitment efforts around Hispanics is a part of the development. So we're working with the Metro Orlando Chamber of Commerce, as Jose Nido mentioned earlier, and some other organizations to do some targeted hiring. But again, I think we, you know, in entry level and kind of mid-manager positions, there's a lot more people than there are at the highest levels of the organization. So that's really the opportunity.
Time for one more question.
Hi, this is Bernice, and just wanted to comment, Aura, on what you mentioned, redacting resumes to focus on talent. I love that you said that. And how do you, what is your recommendation to kind of bring that back to our corporations, that idea, and that, you know, they can follow suit with that so that we're really focused on the talent and working with our staffing partners to give us a diverse pipeline, but without us focusing on, you know, the names and stuff?
Honestly, I started as a pilot, so I identified, quite frankly, one or two people in my organization that I had already developed a rapport with very quickly, And that's what I basically asked, could you, I need a favor. I want to do this. This is why. I identify someone who I anticipated would be a champion for my efforts. And I didn't roll it out like a bulldozer and just said, no, we're doing this for everyone, because I needed to show some success. And that's, the conversation was just around that. I was very transparent, and it was a negotiation. It wasn't just that I came in and said, this is what I want to do and I need you to do this. I explained why I wanted to do it. They had some initial reservations. I work within like one client group, for example, really, really was adamant about GPAs. So I said, okay, we included GPAs, but we wouldn't include the school. So it was, some wanted that, some wanted something else. So it's really, I would recommend finding your champions, finding a client or a partner that will support you on this and pilot it very, very small. And we're tracking this extremely closely, because as I continue to roll this out with my other clients and eventually bring it to leadership on a broader level, I want to show the success. Okay. So that would be my recommendation.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Last one?
Real quick, quick.
Thank you so much for coming. Further to what Robert mentioned, sports, it's a discipline. It builds character, whether you stay on the sport or you move away from the sport. What I feel in the Hispanic community, we have had a vacuum of talented sports people who go into the professional level, meaning this is a talent organization that we built in. Somehow we, and Wendy, thank you so much for receiving them at the Major League Baseball, the discussion is about moms. At the end of the day, the Hispanic mom is the one who decides how to keep that kid, move that kid, sustain that kid. Whether he goes to be an attorney or he wants to be an engineer, forget even being a famous sports. Is your organization targeting the Hispanic mom or the Latina mom? Because that's really the gatekeeper of this sport, the sporting industry.
In terms of what we've been trying to do with Hispanic engagement in tennis, absolutely. We realized early on that the family, engaging the family and the mom in particular, was critical to the success of these introduction events and to keep kids and programs going forward.
I can say with our youth programs, and that it's also a strategic priority for the organization, we're definitely targeting parents. In terms of Latino moms, you're absolutely right. I think that will be the 2.0 of what we're doing with our youth programs in Latino communities, but we understand right now for us, it's focusing on the families when you start talking about Latino inclusion in the sport from players and the actual fan base. So it will evolve, but right now we're more family oriented, the broader base, not specific to moms.
Okay, if you could give a nice round of applause for our panel. Real quick before we leave, if under the desk, not the desk, the table you're at, if you have something that looks like this, you can reach under. We have 25 ESPN laptop bags that we're giving. So, yeah, you can nudge someone out next to you if you don't have one. Where can they collect these? In the back? Right there in the back, the middle exit sign. And thanks again for your participation. We appreciate it. We had a lot of fun today. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Give it up for Max Pareto from ESPN. Thank you very much. And thank you to ESPN. Also, really quickly, this was a few comments about this panel. This is an example of some of the things we want to do, going deeper into particular industries and understanding what are the diversity challenges in particular industries. And I think that, you know, the question that Andre asked, I think is a very good one. And I think it's one that we'll be doing industry by industry, but also working with the sports industry so that we can partner with you so we can move the agenda of having Hispanic inclusion.